Talohani and welcome to Tagata Pasifika. On this morning's show, the factory Webisodes are launched online.
It's about the young generation, you know, their musical tastes are all kind of like, you know, into hip hop and new stuff.
Richmond Rovers Rugby League Club celebrate their 100th anniversary.
It's brought back a lot of good memories for me. Standing here on the hill, I sort of grew up about 15 metres that way, you know, just behind these bushes, so it's a special place for me.
And we meet a young, not-to-be-missed-with ice hockey player.
I don't really let people push me over. I'm, like, most of the girls on the ice, they're, like, quite scared of me.
But first to politics. The Cook Islands, Niue and Tokelau are regarded as part of the realm of New Zealand. This means its people are New Zealand citizens and Wellington has a degree of input into some of its affairs in the islands. Now, this relationship's come under scrutiny lately thanks to the New Zealand Constitutional Review that's underway at the moment. While most debates focused on large issues like the Treaty of Waitangi, there's a sense that Pacific matters, like the realm countries, should be on the agenda as well. In a moment, we'll talk more about this with our studio guests, but first, here's John Utanga.
We believe that a special constitutional relationship be established and entrenched in the constitution, recognizing us as realm people as part of New Zealand right from the beginning.
A strong message from former Cook Islands High Commissioner to New Zealand, Yavita Short, at this meeting in Mangere on Monday. On the agenda, having a say in the constitutional review process, especially for those realm countries.
We've had citizenship, but we actually haven't benefited from that citizenship. And as a result, our people are at the bottom of the pile. Rather than at the top of the pile, we're at the bottom of the pile in terms of education, health, the fact that our kids aren't doing well.
The Cooks is the largest realm country, but its leaders admit complacency.
I think we've been a bit lax in fighting for our rights. I think we've been a bit disorganised. And I think it's time for Cook Island people to wake up and start, you know, stepping forward. You know, I'm glad that we now have a Member of Parliament who is a Cook Islander.
Meanwhile, Niuean leaders point out the relationship works for migrants, but not necessarily for those in the islands.
And they fit in smoothly to the structures and systems here in New Zealand. But the people that are left behind in the islands, perhaps there's not the equity that is desirous out of the relationship.
And the deadline for submissions to the review committee has been extended until the end of July.
And joining me now to talk more about this issue is Tokelauan Everdina Fully and Niuean Dr. Nuhi Sifa Seve Williams. Thank you for both for joining us on the show. Nuhi, first of all, why is it so important for Pacific realm countries to take part in this constitutional review?
I think it's important because we are New Zealand citizens. We don't have access to any other passport but a New Zealand passport. And so it's important for us to participate in any discussions in New Zealand that has implications for our citizenship.
And you're helping to get together a UN submission. Why is it important for a UN voice to be in that mix?
Well, again, I mean, I go back to what I said earlier. It's important because we need to be more visible in terms of our needs here in New Zealand.
Everdina, for Tokelauans, is it even more important for Tokelauan people to be aware that this is happening?
Absolutely. In regards to the people on the ground, a lot of them aren't aware, you know, that this constitutional review is actually has been undertaken. And that it's not, you know, it's not long before the submissions have to come together. And so we have different levels of New Zealand society that are informed about it. But the main bulk on the ground, you know, it's really important to inform them and just let them know what's happening, the kind of impact it might have if they don't participate in the process. Mm. Because it is about their citizenship and about the future of our people and what that might mean. And it's ruled by legislation. And so that's the significant part about it.
Do you think people who are, you know, New Zealanders who are Tokelauan, Cook Islanders and Niueans, do you think they have been neglected thus far in the process?
I think yes, they have been neglected. In terms of where they have a commission, a group, a panel, we have our Pacific representative and who represents the Pacific. But I don't think what happened in that process is they forgot about the realm countries, the fact that we were actual citizens of this, mm-hmm. and we should have had a representative on that particular committee to give voice, you know, to the direction forward. That actually might have helped this process a lot faster.
Mm-hmm. Has there been oversight for people back home in the islands as well?
Yes, absolutely, because as far as I know, our people back in Tokelau, you know, there's whakaofo, nukunono, and tafu haven't been informed. And they have the same status as us in New Zealand here. And as far as I am aware, they're not informed about this process, and they have to be informed. We're bound by legislation. If we go through this consultation process, then those people back in Tokelau, back in Niue, back in the Cook Islands, have to be informed. I'm not too sure what direction this particular government committee will have, but there needs to be some careful consideration. That was highlighted in a radio interview I had undertaken about a month ago, that was the government's responsibility.
Mm. Okay, and Yavita Short mentions that, you know, everyone should wake up. Is that a call for our Pacific people?
Yes, I think it's an important call. I think sometimes when we think about the realm countries, there is a sense of apathy and complacency, primarily in terms of people who believe that they have the privilege of citizenship and therefore they have not had to struggle in terms of getting New Zealand citizenship. So what you get in a sense, people are quite complacent and they think that they're privileged. But where that complacency has come, hasn't improved outcomes in terms of our people. So we're complacent in a sense. We know we're privileged because we have New Zealand citizenship, but we don't have better outcomes in terms of our social and economic status in New Zealand.
Okay, Everdina, do you see a danger if people don't take part in the process? And I think there's about 3 weeks, is that right, till these submissions close?
Absolutely. One of the highlights of the last consultation Pacific in Auckland about a month and a half ago was that very question, was, you know, what will happen if we don't participate? Mm-hmm. And there was a rollout, you know, of responses from the three islands, the realm nations. And one of the careful considerations that we were worried about was, if we don't participate, will the status of our people in the various sectors of the society, education, employment, health and so forth, will that is likely to get worse and not better? And so this actual time gives our people a voice so that they can tell us what it is that they want, you know, in order to ensure that the legislation in regards to the constitutional review will encapsulate the thoughts and the dreams and hopes of our people, particularly of our people who came here in the early 50s, 60s, and particularly in the 70s, what they hoped for. And so it's our responsibility to give back to the next generation.
We've touched on the Niuean, Cook Islands and Tokelau community. What about for other Pacific groups? Is it just as important that they take part?
Absolutely. Yes. One of the things that was highlighted in that meeting that we had in Auckland was we didn't want to use the divide and rule principle, one whereby which when government sets up a particular directive, everyone starts, you know, arguing. It was more around the other Pacific groups understood where we came from for the fact that they had their own governance or their own governments in their own islands and could see that we could have a voice here in terms of the realm countries. And so the submission is a call to government about our position and what that means for the various islands. And I think one of the key highlights was that we weren't a homogenous group. And in actual fact, we came from different nations, and that had to be carefully addressed.
Okay, and just quickly, Nuhi, where to from here?
Well, there are plans to hold separate community meetings for the three groups. We didn't have the opportunity to hold these meetings prior to the round meeting on Monday, but because the constitutional review submission deadline has been extended to the end of July, we feel now that we have time to consult with our communities and then come back and have discussions again as to whether we put in a submission for realm countries or whether we put in separate ones.
Okay, well, thank you both for coming on the show
today.
Thank you.
Later in the show, Klapa singing.
A Klapa group actually originally is about a whole bunch of friends. It's how it starts.
And players gather to celebrate Richmond Rovers' centenary.
And you look at the park and say, man, this is a field of dreams, and we didn't even know it at the time.
welcome back to Tagata Pasifika. Pacific Island theatre company Killer Coconut Crew have launched the first ever South Auckland Webisode series.
Yes, following the highly successful musical The Factory, the group have taken their theatre skills and applied them to the online film screen.
Sanele Chadwick was there on the last day of filming.
The Killer Coconut Crew has entertained New Zealand audiences for years, and they're at it again with their new online show The Factory.
It's really important for us that we are showing South Auckland's true light, you know, in a true light, and not just kind of going, oh, here we all are in the hood and, you know, we're doing drugs and skipping school. It's, you know, this is such a colourful, creative hub for talent.
Webisodes are released twice weekly and follows three generations of the Saumalu family who work in a factory. One day, the father decides his family is going to enter a singing competition.
What's this?
Ah, the big talent competition.
Yeah.
X Factory. All the South Auckland businesses are entering. Keith wants us to represent for Murdoch's. Us as in you kids.
It's here where the battle between the traditional and contemporary begins.
It's about the young generation, you know, their musical tastes are all kind of like, they're, you know, into hip-hop and new stuff, and they want, you know, auto-tune and things like that. And then you've got the traditional, you know, Tingy the grandfather, and it's about how do they find that middle ground.
More than half the cast involved have never acted before, including academic Bentel Fua, who plays Tingy.
Keith, the hongi is a Māori thing.
Today, Taufu is rubbing shoulders with the big names, and despite his inexperience, he says being an islander helps.
I would argue that my whole life is acting, exposed to Sunday school stuff.
The Factory's following has become so popular, Auckland Mayor Len Brown makes an appearance.
Hey, you kids, keep the noise down, otherwise I'll call the council.
Well, I'm the Pulunuhu Aokalani. And so, being a boy from the south side in particular, obviously very, very strong links and friends amongst the Pasifika community.
I'm gonna crush it, sir!
Somalu!
Somalu soldiers! What's up? What's up? What's up?
Now that's what's up. To sports now. They're one of the oldest rugby league clubs in Auckland, and last month they celebrated their 100-year anniversary in style.
Of course, we're talking about the Richmond Rovers League Club in the heart of Auckland. It's a club that's had its share of ups and downs, but one which remains firmly family-oriented and with a strong Pasifika presence. John Otunga went down to Grayland Park for this story.
Grayland Park, Saturday morning. The Richmond Rovers under-8s are playing Ponsonby in the blue.
Go low, guys!
It's one of many games played here for a club which prides itself on its family atmosphere.
It's like a whole like family involvement. My husband coaches and I manage, and then it's just a real togetherness thing to do on the weekends. There are a lot of established families that have been here for years, and it's a very strong family club. It's like our second home. For our club in particular, it is predominantly Pacific Island, but we do have a lot of European kids playing who have come from soccer. They've played league and they're really enjoying it too.
On this day, all Richmond teams have home games, a gesture to help mark the club's centenary, 100 years on the Auckland Rugby League scene. The club's roots go back to 1913, solidly working class and mostly Palangi. But with the influx into the area of Pacific migrants in the 1960s and 70s, it just seemed a natural fit for many families. Club stalwarts Peter R. Coy remembers when his family joined the club in the late 1960s.
At that time, there were established Polynesian families already at Richmond. In particular was the Tokelau community. Olenga Toloa, he was actually playing for Richmond. As a premier player back in the 60s, and he stood out a mile because he was the only sort of brown person in the team.
My parents didn't want us to go any other park because this is the park they can see from the house. They wanted to know where the kids were, man. And said, oh, we want to go play for Ponsonby down the road at Clarence Street. Can't see you down there. Go down there in Grand Park where I can see you and I know where you guys are at. So it's been a foundation for a lot of us. And you look at your park and say, man, this is a field of dreams, and we didn't even know it at the time.
Fred Akoi returned from his home in the United States for the celebrations, as did many other of the club's players and homegrown stars.
Yeah, it's good to be back, you know, back in Grayland, back down here at Richmond. It's brought back a lot of good memories for me. Standing here on the hill, I sort of grew up about 15 metres that way, you know, just behind these bushes, so it's a special place for me.
My family's been playing here for well over 50 years now, so to come back and play, to come down here and that, you know, I've been a part of Richmond's been a part of my life for such a long time.
Richmond Rovers has a proud history in both the men's and women's game, but it's had some tough recent years on and off the field. On the field, it needs its top side back in the Fox Memorial competition. Off the field, the changing face of the inner city communities brought its share of problems.
We still have a lot of Polynesian groups that and the families that live here. Although they can't afford to live in Greyland now, but they're still passionate about the area and the sport itself. It's very tough, but as you know, with the communities that we have, we've kept it going for 100 years. And I feel that we'll go for another 100 years.
Time now for community notices with the new track, Rags to Riches by Scylla.
After the break, Klapa, Samoana sing and ice hockey.
Got a lot of little girls in New Zealand, and it would be great to have more stuff going on skating than they make natural hockey players.
Welcome back to Tagata Pasifika. Now, singing without instrumental backing is nothing new for Pacific people, but a cappella group Klapa Samoana are taking it to a new level.
They're winging their way to Croatia right now. Karima Fayai has more.
A cappella is their strong suit. But this is no ordinary a cappella group.
I heard this kind of music that was Klapa music, and it was a different sort of thing. It was like a whole bunch of guys jamming, so I just wanted to try it out. And so I was like, okay, you guys come here, we try this out, see how it works.
Klapa is a form of a cappella group singing from southern Croatia. Klapa groups can include as many as 12 singers who focus largely on vocal harmony and fellowship.
A Klapa group actually originally is about a whole bunch of friends. That's how it starts. And then friends start drinking, and then when they're drinking, then they start singing, and when they sing, then they decide, oh, we actually sound okay. I think about barbershop, there is, you know, that kind of showmanship which is needed, all of that. Klapa music is very much directed the other way around. You're not expected to look out into the audience, you're supposed to expected to look out into each other and let the music carry it and the story, and so that's one of the big differences.
Hoping to draw more Pacific people to the genre, Klapa Samoana have been blending the style with traditional Polynesian songs.
The chords and everything that we use are very similar to what they use. The language is just a bit harder. Samoan has a whole lot of words, you know, to say one small thing.
There actually is a lot of like common things that they both have. Like, I know a lot of us are passionate when we sing our Pacific music. The same with Croatian. So I guess in that sense we're able to adapt to it easier than what we would have thought.
Founded by Christian Maliator Brown, the group's made up of friends who sang together in the school choir.
You've seen the development in these boys here and how they've gone from like one level to another, and it's amazing to see the change and the development.
As a leader of the group, I wish I wasn't a lot of the time because it's sometimes it's like herding cats. It sounds like the Oriental Express.
Christian, he's serious, strict, a bit too strict sometimes, but yeah. But he's good, like he has two sides of him, that serious side when you have to get something done and sort of muck around sort of type.
You know, we know each other very well, you know, how to annoy each other, how to make each other feel better, and so it's brotherhood in a true sense, I guess.
Klapa Samoana are currently on tour, performing throughout Europe, finishing with a guest performance at the Omish International Klapa Festival, Croatia, in July.
We're taking their music back to them. If the French came here with a haka and performed it to the Maldives would be like, what?
We can bring something to the
the Croatians. They appreciate the brown sound, so I'm looking forward to just bringing that to them.
To be able to go there and see that side of the world with these guys that I've been singing with, whose friendship I cherish a lot, and who mean a lot to me, makes it even more of a dream.
Sound great, guys. Well, ice hockey's a sport that doesn't feature many Pacific players, but for more than 5 years, it's been the passion of young Christine Penitani in Christchurch.
Not bad for the young 18-year-old who had to learn how to skate before she learned how to play the sport. Sandra Kailahi has this story from the mainland.
Christchurch has a small Pacific population, and the number of Pacific female ice hockey players there, well, you're looking at her. 18-year-old Christine Penitani is Māngaian Cook Islander and Tongan and is a former New Zealand development player and member of the Cantabrian women's team. She got interested in the sport after visiting her foster mum's grandson in the US about 5 years ago. And when she returned home, she decided she'd better first learn how to skate.
Well, I went to every public sessions on Wednesday nights and Friday nights and Saturday afternoons and Saturday nights and Sunday afternoons. And then all the staff here started recognising me, and I started in a league called Bantams League. I was still quite wobbly and still falling over and stuff, because the really hard thing to do is being able to skate and being able to do puck handling with your stick.
Then as she got better, so did her accomplishments, first with the Canterbury Women's Ice Hockey Team.
So it went from the Canterbury Women's Ice Hockey Team, which is, their name's the Canterbury Devilettes, and then at Nationals, there's trials there, so I went onto the New Zealand Ice Ferns squad, yeah. Someone that's coming to me, usually I just, like, because they come down this way, and because, like, I play defence, and so I just, like, skate backwards, keep my knees bent and like look at their chest. If you look at their chest, that's where their body will go. Usually I just bring them out so then they can't have a clear shot on the neck.
Christine's got really good skating technique, and she's also fast, and she's quite big and strong, which is what we need in an ice hockey player. Got a lot of little girls in New Zealand, and it would be great to have more stuff going on skating than they make natural hockey players. Because they've got lots of speed and lots of acceleration as well as having good size.
I don't really let people push me over. Like most of the girls on the ice, they're like quite scared of me because I always bump them around, so that some people are like really grateful that they're on my team. I like taking people out. When I do nudge people like fully, I get penalty, so I go in the penalty box.
Christine has taken a break from the New Zealand development team to pursue her studies with NZIS, but she's still passionate about the game and what she wants to achieve.
Well, I do hope one day that I'll play in the Worlds. The girls had their Worlds this year in April, and they might be off to the Olympics, the Winter Olympics, maybe. I do hope to play in the Worlds at some point. Lisa!
And congratulations to Christine, who's just made the Canterbury women's team again for the Nationals in August.
Well, that's our show for today. Remember, you can catch all our stories and find out what's happening in the community online at tvnz.co.nz, keyword Tagata Pasifika. On Facebook, just like us. And we're on YouTube as well.
Have a great weekend.
Kia manuina. People proud.